Hello, Shirley Adams here with Series 12, Program 2. Silk is called the Queen of Fibers, and it does indeed have a royal history. Beloved and highly valued for centuries, we see more silk today than we have the last two decades. Let's look at silks, how to best handle them, how to care for them, and how to make those puzzling decisions involved. What we have here on the table is one type of silk, and this is extremely heavy. It's coating. And you can see how very heavy all those yarns are. They're as big as my finger, some of them. And also, look at the bright colors, because this is one of the neat things about silk, the fact that it does take dyes so well. Well, it goes all the way from this very heavy silk to very lightweight blouse silks and scarf silks. Let's look at the models, though, a little bit and see a few other things that they're going to show you. What we have here first is a black, really scrunchy silk. And what's neat about this is that it has been through the washer and dryer, and it will continue to go through the washer and dryer. And it just gets pulled out of the dryer, and it's ready to wear because there is no pressing involved. So if you think that silk is a very time-consuming, very difficult fabric, not necessarily so. It can be this easy. A very versatile outfit, just the pants and the blouse. We can dress that up and down and do a lot of things with it. The other one there you've seen before, and this was from Series 9, right at the end of it. It's a bog coat, and it's where you just sort of make a couple of cuts and fold the fabric and sew it together. And this one is out of silk, kind of a thin blouse silk, a coordinate actually. The skirt and blouse are made to go together, and a little of them are mixed. But this also is a great traveler. I find, even though it does need pressing right at first when I was constructing it, I don't recall pressing this for a long, long time, and it's traveled a lot. So it does fold up and go in the suitcase very easily and comes out looking just fine. Actually, if there's a wrinkle when you arrive at your destination, hang it in a steamy bathroom for a little bit and it'll be okay then. The wrinkles will just drop out. Then we see another grouping of them here. And these are all suiting silks. These are all heavier ones. The first one there, the lavender one, is just a vest and a skirt. And this is just fun to play with. All of these, no, not all of them. This one might be put, though, in the silk matka class, is what this is called. There are so many names for various silk fabrications. This one, I was just lucky enough to have some yarn the identical color that's couched in place on there, and later in the series we'll talk about that and show you how to do that. But a very easy fabric to work with. The next one then is a royal blue, and suitable since it has this royal background. And this is a summer suit, of course, with its short sleeves. But again, very versatile. That little neck piece just snaps right out. It's removable if you want a slightly lower neck, or you can put any sort of insets in if you want to change the look a little. But again, silk travels beautifully, handles nicely, very easy. Another one here is this rosy hued one, and cut quite low, so it has to have a blouse under it or something inside at least. But this also is just a summer suit, and different fabrication. This one is a little nubby here and there, a little slub yarn, a dupioni really is what it is. Then the last one there is an interesting one, again, a silk matka. Now, these are surprisingly inexpensive. You worry about what's the cost of this silk. Not all that much. This one in particular was a great bargain. And right now it's shown with this solid skirt. But eventually, I am going to make another skirt, not even in this series, actually, but eventually I'll have another skirt, because this, with its metallic overprint, is kind of a dressy one, and so it deserves a skirt that looks like it's ready for a big evening, too. So it will eventually have something soft and floaty and multi-layered that I'll show you later in the series, even though I won't have it made. But anyway, you can see there are several different kinds of silks here. They're all very easy to handle, extremely easy. Now let's take a look at the rack and see some other garments. I have a collection of blouses here, all of them silk. And one of the first questions is always going to be, how do you handle these? Are you going to wash them? Or are you going to dry clean them? It depends on the fabric and the color, really. So some of these, the first group of them here, I'm going to wash them all. And here's one that I just finished. I pre-washed any of these that I'm going to ever wash. I'll pre-wash them. And once it's already washed, then fine. You won't have any problems thereafter. This one went through the washer, the dryer, kind of a gentle cycle both places, and it didn't fade at all that I noticed. There's a little bit of contention on the fact that maybe it does some good to put salt or vinegar in the original wash water. Maybe it doesn't. There's a little research going both ways. I didn't choose to do so in this, and it didn't seem to make any difference. When this came out of the dryer, it really needed no touch-up pressing even. It was ready to go. So a very easy one if you think silk is difficult, not necessarily. This one is kind of in a shady area. And what I have opted to do with this, even though it should be washable at the crepe de chine, because of those colors, if any of those colors bleed onto the others, it would kind of destroy this really good print. And so I think I shall choose to dry clean this one. But I do have some other washables here. This one is has been pre-washed, and so no problem here. It, again, has kind of a sand-washed feel. It is a charmeuse, but with a jacquard weave there. You can see there's a little print in the background before they printed the different colors on it. So that's a washable. Here's another one, very much washable, a sand-washed blouse. It's been through the washer and dryer several times. But again, treating them gently. These short-sleeved ones, both of them, are just easy-to-wash silks. Where you get into some problems, another one here, just a sand-washed silk, again a charmeuse, which means a satiny type look on the outside. But where you get into problems are when you find the crepe yarns. This is where you better take a second look. Now this one's creped. I decided though, because of the color, the value is all about the same color, you know, the tone, I decided to go ahead and wash this. Didn't do any problem at all. This one, though, I accidentally washed. Now, I didn't mean to, partially because of its deep purple color, partially because it's a creped yarn, and that means a tightly twisted yarn. And when you wash this natural fiber of the tightly twisted yarns, it could and probably will shrink. So you can see with the length of the sleeves here, comparing it to the ones surrounding them, this did indeed shrink. It isn't a total loss. On another program, I'm going to show you how you can restore that and bring it back to life again. Some of these, the rest of them, because of their dark colors, here's one in particular, the light color with the black, I'm afraid that black will bleed. I therefore will take this to the cleaner. Those that have shoulder pads in, by the way, are those that I probably will clean. Those without, I'll just put removable ones in when I wear them because it's easier to wash and press if you don't have the shoulder pads in. What I have down here are a couple of surprises as far as the silk goes itself. This one you just saw last week, and it's a very thin silk. It's a blouse silk, but it's been heavily treated, and it's also supported with a backing, and therefore it makes up nicely into a jacket because it has all these extra layers on it. Then this one you saw, two, three series ago, probably back in series 8. This is the thinnest silk I have on the rack, and yet it's a jacket because it also is all quilted and pieced and backed. So because of that backing, a fleece backing, then it's fine to use it as a jacket, even though it is such a lightweight silk. Then I have some here I'd like to talk about in a minute, and I'll just put them down here. But what I want to talk about first is how you're going to pre-treat this, if it's going to need pre-treating. Well, I have the same sample that I'm wearing, and this is how I would pre-treat it. I would first of all just take one corner of it and stitch a 6-inch square. Now make sure that is a perfect 6 inches, both directions. And what that is 1/6 of a yard. If it shrinks as much as 1/4 inch, that means per yard it will shrink 1.5 inches. You don't want that much shrinkage later, so you want to definitely get all that out before it ever starts. Now what you do after you stitch that off is just steam press it heavily. And what I would do is simply, and if I turn on the steam table or the exhaust system there, we can get all that steam going through, and then it won't be such a puff up above here. Now what I would like to do is just get this all tested, and of course before you measure this again, you want to make sure all the steam's out and it's dry. That's one of the neat things about this exhaust table, the fact that it does vacuum it out, and then I can test it again, measure it again to see if it shrank at all. And if so, I'm going to pre-shrink the whole piece, which would be just heavily steaming. And either you do that or send it to the cleaners to have it done. But you want to make sure it's completely pre-shrunk before you do anything to it. Now later, I'm going to, of course, dry clean this suit, but it's not the dry cleaning fluid that will shrink it. It's the construction pressing, because you must press every step along the way to do a really good job. Well, what I also want to do while I'm here at the board is decide what I'm going to interface it with. Almost always I use in suits, no matter what the fabric is, almost always I'm going to use a fusible interfacing of this weft construction. They're easy to find in the interfacing departments of all the fabric shops. And because this is really quite a soft silk, even though it's heavy, this is another one of those called silk matka, and even though it's a little bit heavy, it's very soft, and I think these caps of the sleeves are just going to droop. So what I would also like to do, even though I have the fronts and around the hems interfaced with that heavier interfacing, I think it would be probably a good idea to just fuse a little bit here on the sleeve cap. And I'm not necessarily going to do the whole thing, the whole long sleeve. Here I just have a sample, but I won't do the whole long sleeve. I'll just do the cap, just so that it's a little crisper and so that it works out well. It is possible, however, if you prefer, to just go ahead and fuse the whole sleeve, but something lightweight, because you don't want it to be as heavy as the jacket front. So looking through all these interfacings, you just choose whatever seems best. And when I don't know, and I really don't know in advance for sure what I'm going to use as interfacings, then I like to have a little bit on hand of every kind available in my stash so that I can try it out on a scrap to decide for sure which one's going to be the best. When it comes to the lightweight things, the blouses as opposed to the constructed suit jackets, I'm always going to do this with interfacing. I will cut out the interfacing and I'll go ahead and fuse it to the uncut fabric, and then afterwards I'll cut out the facing, because that's the easiest way. It's very hard when you fuse to get two little pieces like this to mesh just right without getting some of that stickiness on the ironing board or on the iron. So think about that. Cut out the interfacing first and fuse, and it does help. Now, what I also wanted to talk about and why I brought these over is because I wanted to show you the difference between three skirts. And the first one that I have here really looks kind of limp, kind of like an old dishcloth. And what I have inside that skirt is absolutely nothing. It is just the one layer of fabric, and that's all. And that wasn't enough. And I find, even though you wear a slip under it, it isn't enough. This skirt is one that I don't feel good in. In fact, I don't remember wearing it more than about once and deciding I really don't like that. What I have in this second skirt, which is a whole lot better, is a layer of lining. And it's much, much nicer. It gives it some extra crispness, and it just makes it hang better, look better. It feels more dressed, more finished. But what I have in this third skirt is the best yet. For this particular fabric, not every fabric, but what I have here is not only the lining, but I also have a layer of underlining. And what I have used here for underlining is some silk organza. And you just use that as one with the fabric. You stay stitch around the edges, and then you have the two fabrics together. What's nice about it, as I just separated it, is the fact that you can hem to that underlining, and then no hem shows on the outside if you have that problem in some of your things. So that's always a good deal also, to have that there. Now, always I do not put that backing in. I just, in fact, took one of my skirts that I had made, and I had already put the underlining in it, and after I had it finished, it was too much, and I had to take it all out. And it's worth taking it out, of course. If it isn't going to be to your satisfaction, I'll take the time to take it out, because if it isn't really a nice garment, why would you even want to bother with it? You want everything that you make to be very special and to have those really top-notch qualities. Well, what I'm going to do with a little sample here, here I have the underlining, the silk organza in this case. Now, this is not an expensive silk. This organza is just meant as an under fabric. And so it's not expensive, really. And if you find some in a store at a good price, because it might vary $5 one way or the other at various stores, if you find some at a good price, What I do is buy about 10 yards or so of it because I'm going to use it under a lot of things and I like to have it on hand. So I buy one in a light neutral and one in a dark neutral. So black and white is usually what I have on hand that goes in everything. And to stay stitch this, you would just, of course, go all around the edge to attach the two layers together within the seam allowance somewhere, not where you'd have to rip it out later, not out where it's going to show. But then also what I want to put in this is a dart. And here can be a problem when you have underlined fabric and you want a dart in. Well, to just fold this and try to get it all working just right, probably that underlining will come a little loose and stick up above. So it's a good idea to, I'm going to enlarge the stitches here by several because I just want to baste this center of the dart together. I don't have one marked, so I'll just take a straight line down the center of it just to baste them together. And then once they're basted, and I'm going to make that a little bit longer than what the dart will actually be because I want to make sure they stay together. And then after that's done, then it's very easy to just fold right along that center line that's basted. And after you have that folded, then just go ahead and construct your dart. And we better get it down to smaller sizes again to do that. And no problem then, it sticks together very nicely. Now because this fabric is kind of loosely woven, I am not going to slash this dart open. I would, however, with some darts, because it's going to be flatter when you press them, sometimes I would slash those open. This is going to be a rather small one, so no. I will just finish this up by whatever means you like to finish the tip of a dart so it looks really, really nice. If you can backstitch accurately on that little tiny nothingness that's there, fine. If you can't, you might just stitch off the edge and then come back here just to attach it with a couple of stitches where it is, just so that it can be attached and yet not have any thickness there at the point of that dart. Because when it's all pressed open over a nice curved surface, you want it to look very, very smooth there. So this is how you would do a dart that's underlined, which is a little bit different than what you're perhaps used to. Some other things that you want to consider. Remember that hem I showed you in the skirt a minute ago? I want to think, okay, if I'm going to underline that, what do I do about the very bottom of it? For instance, am I going to just go ahead and serge this so that I put a finish on it and then fold it up? Probably not, because I want them, as I said, to be really good. And so look what happens. It's called the turn of the cloth is what happens. And as I fold this up, notice how right now they're exactly together. Those two layers of fabric are right together. But as I turn this up, because one is a little heavier than the other and because the outer one folds around a longer distance, can you see how now you can see a little bit more of that white organza that's sticking out there? So I want to fold them up first, possibly go ahead and press them first before I then go to the serger and serge that edge, serge the two together. And if I first press those, then I will put a pin somewhere here in the area to keep them together while I serge them. Certainly not near the edge because you don't want to come too close to it with that serger, but perhaps just back here, somewhere out of the way, but so that it keeps that roll line in it, and it's going to be much nicer for doing that. Anytime I have a hem like this, let me bring this one over again to show you. Anytime I have this kind of a hem, I said that I like to hem it to the actual underlining, and that means hemming it by hand, more than likely. It isn't going to be a very easy job to do it any other way. This one, by the way, I used some hem lace, some hem tape. Any of those are possible, a serge or finish, whatever you prefer. It doesn't matter. I use them all. But this one does have to be a hand stitch, and you just stitch carefully as you put your needle in to go through that organza, but then get it loose. Make sure you don't go all the way through to the bottom, and then come back up in the hem and go around like that with a single layer of thread. Just make sure you avoid that outside silk layer. Or if I would rather, and I usually do, if I would rather just do a machine hem, a blind hem, and this works beautifully. It's a very easy one to do. And how we would do this one is, first of all, finish that fabric. Here's one that's finished. It's already been serged on the edge. Turn up the hem, and I would go ahead and press this hem first. And then after it's pressed, I'm going to put some pins, oh, maybe about this far from the edge. I want to have the head sticking out because I am going to pull them out before I get to them. And I would go ahead and press this first to make sure it is just right. And notice how I'm coming down about a half inch probably before I stick this pin in. And the reason for that is when I hem this, I am going to, with the blind hem, I'm going to turn this back and I will basically stitch on the hem edge here, but then it'll go catch the skirt here and there a couple inches above or an inch and a half above the fold line at the bottom. Now the reason I'm doing this, have you ever had hems that really showed dreadfully? Perhaps because you just stitch too close to the edge. Well, that's what happens if you stitch right up here close to the edge. And then when you press it, you press that that outside, that edge against it, and you have that impression showing on the right side of your fabric. This is why it's kind of a good idea. And look at some of the expensive ready-to-wear. I always use this as my model. I always like to get some ideas from the expensive ready-to-wear because they have good ideas there. They do it the expensive way. And what they do is usually come down here a little bit and not go right at the top. Now, I've already taken the foot off. I better put a blind hem foot on this, so I can do a little bit of hemming. And then I'm going to get my stitch over here so that I have a blind hem stitch. Here's a good one. And I'll be ready to go. Now what this blind hem stitch is going to do, of course, is, and I like the way this foot has a little thing that comes down, a little projection underneath, so that it stays right against the fold of the fabric. Therefore, I can't do anything wrong. I don't have to watch it that carefully as I do this stitching, because it's going to hold everything in place and I can't go in too far. It'll do just right. Although if you find after you stitch a little bit, if this is actually coming in more than you want it to, and you can see I'll go slowly, that about every fourth stitch, fifth stitch, it goes over and catches the skirt barely. But you can see when you do this that it can go really fast. You could never hem by hand this fast. And so it is a good deal if you haven't used that blind hem capacity. I think it's probably on about every machine, so you probably have it on yours. But notice that when this is all finished, this is what it looks like. And on the outside, because of course I used a contrasting thread so you could see, it barely shows. But by the time you would use the same color thread, it really wouldn't show at all. When you press this, it would be very good then if you would go ahead and press down here, but don't put the iron over the raw edge or over the finished edge here, if you can help it, because that's going to then show an impression through on the outside. Now you can do these things so beautifully, and then you send it to cleaners, and if they aren't as discriminating as you are, there's no guarantee that they are going to do it as well. But let's hope they'll follow your lead and do a nice job. What I might want also in those blouses, not in the jackets, because the jacket's going to be covered by lining. The shoulder pad won't show there. But in those blouses, I'm not going to take them off in public. Nobody's going to see them but me. But I like to have finished pads in them, just again, because it makes a more special garment. So what I have here is an uncovered pad. This is just a poly foam pad that you can buy in the notions departments of any of the stores. I like to cover them with this, and I have a square of fabric here, and this is going to be on the bias. You can see there's the selvage. Therefore, when I fold this over, this will be bias, and I'm going to do this to cover them. And you can do this directly on your serger. I usually find it easier to sew around there to make it really perfect on the machine by putting a few pins in, take it out when I come to them, and then after I have that one line just very quickly stitched around there close to the edge, but I want to slightly catch that pad, then I can cut off the fabric, serge the edge, and you have a lovely pad. Make sure that you leave the built-in shape when you do this, and this is the purpose also of putting pins in there, so that you can keep that shape instead of flattening them out, which won't look nearly as nice when it's finished. Now, I know some of you are going to ask me, so I'll answer the question in advance. Did I do all this embroidery on the jacket? What I want to say about that is the fact that, yes, you can do it. No, I did not do this. Here I just tried it though. As I looked at this fabric, I thought what they have done in the manufacturing process, they have, I'm looking at the wrong side, let's see the right side. If you look closely at this, what you see here is ribbon floss, which you also can get in any fabric or sewing machine shop. And it comes in a wide variety of colors. I found one that's almost the very same shade as theirs. And what I did with this, and we won't have time to do it, but I'll tell you about it. What I did with this ribbon floss is wind it on a bobbin, put it in the regular bobbin case, but I loosened the tension on that bobbin. Now, if your machine won't do this, then think of some other ways to do it. You might couch it on instead, you might do some other things. So don't loosen that tension unless you're sure that it can be done on your brand of machine. But this is what I did to do this. I just loosened that little screw, and I stitched this with the wrong side up. As I stitched this, I had regular sewing thread in the top. I have two layers of fabric here because I had the underlining with it. And then I just did this stitching round and round, and this is how it looked using the bobbin that way. So that is a possibility. Well, I don't want you to be frightened with silk because of the apparent cost. Don't compare silk with polyester and think it's the same thing. It isn't. Go look at the ready-to-wear and see what those silk blouses cost and just see how much you save then by making them yourself. This is the more sensible way to compare them because this is really what you're doing, apples to apples instead of apples to oranges. Something else I kind of like to do on some of these skirts, I've told you before how I sometimes use elastic because they feel very comfortable. On this one, what I have done is taken the regular interfacing that you can buy, but I've cut it down narrower because I like a little narrow waistband. So whatever is your preference, silks turn out to be really pretty easy, and they just produce fabulous results. Well, speaking of that, next time we'll be meeting the Fab Four. The Beatles? No. Frogs. Come join me then to learn about some fabulous frogs.